This recording is protected by copyright. No part may be reproduced without the prior permission of the University of South Australia.
Hi everyone. So my name's Scott Polley. I'm the Program Director of Human Movement. And obviously here today to find a little bit more about the degree. The session will go for around about 20 to 25 minutes. And at the end there'll be opportunities to ask questions and clarify any information that you need. You can also go down to one of the booths. We have a booth there, and just ask people one-on-one. So thanks very much for coming. I hope this session does answer your questions. First of all, the safety stuff. So there is a fire exit plan which is on there. Basically, if someone decides to start a fire, if you could just proceed to that exit or that exit and make your way out, that'll be lovely. Thank you. So first of all, that's the general information. We know that last year the cutoff was 84.75. There weren't any specific prerequisites, but we always recommend people, if possible, to do some science. It's just going to be very helpful, particularly in the first year, because first year is about sort of 50-50 bioscience and social science. So any kind of background that you have in things like biology or physics, chemistry, maths, any of those kind of things are helpful. It doesn't mean if you haven't done those, you shouldn't do human movement, but it just will mean that when we start to get in those early concepts, if you're not very familiar with them, you might find it takes you a little bit longer just to work your way through them. We're based at City East. But we also have a lot of practical work at other campuses, such as McGill, Mawson Lakes, and also other environments. So with such a title like Human Movement, people often ask, what actually is it? And we do every year, even ourselves, we go, right, should we keep calling it Human Movement, or should we change it to some other title? And for us as academics, it makes a lot of sense to keep it as Human Movement. But perhaps, to the general public and recognition, we argue, should we call it exercise science, exercise and sports science, those sorts of things. But it's still human movement for the moment. It is an internationally recognised term, and, it's obviously about how we move and the factors that influence the way that we move. And I guess it's linked very squarely with health. So it's human movement and health studies, and we've firmly placed ourselves in that health domain. It's an old discipline, and I guess, started in Roman and Greek times, this idea that perhaps we should be not just moving, for work, but in fact we should be encouraging people to move for pleasure, but also perhaps for the good of society. So it's not a new thing. We've been going for a very long time. But I thought I'd at least leave you with some interesting information, even if you don't do human movement, because this is partly why I'm here. Firstly, we know that young people's fitness is decreasing worldwide, so this is a worldwide pattern. We also know that life expectancy is continuing to increase overall, but there's a really interesting phenomena that we have where the age of chronic disease is not changing. So in other words, on average, the year level that people start to get chronic disease is exactly the same, but we're living longer with this chronic disease. And we need to look at how we can do something about that. We know that cardiovascular disease is second only to cancer as Australia's biggest killer. And we know that physical activity is one of the reasons why it's still at such high levels. We know that about 20% of Australians have a cardiac condition. Again, physical activity is one of the key reasons why that's happening. We know that physically active people are up to 2 times less likely to have a cardiovascular incident. So the single biggest protective factor for cardiovascular disease is physical activity, even more than weight. We also know that Australians have more leisure time than ever, but when you survey people and ask them about you know, why you're not active, they say, because I don't have enough time. So we have an issue where we have, in theory, less work time, supposedly more leisure, but we're not filling it up with physical activity. Interestingly, the people who work the least hours, who have the most free time, have even lower levels of physical activity. Finally, I guess the key message is that physical activity is the fourth highest risk factor for chronic illness. So basically, you know, it sits behind smoking, nutrition, as one of those key areas. But the big thing about it is it's something we can modify. And so human movement is really interested in how we can get people in a range of areas more active. The cost of physical inactivity at the moment is staggering, estimated to be around about $14 billion. And we know that about 15 million Australians are considered insufficiently active. Now, insufficiently active is 150 minutes a week of moderate, at least moderate physical activity. On top of that, we have around about 12 million Australians who are overweight or obese. So why we're here is we want to get people moving. We want to get people moving for life. So we think that our degree and our graduates are well placed to be able to provide, I guess, advice, interventions and action to help us become a more active society. And we draw upon a range of fields, you know, such as anatomy, physiology, psychology, physics, sociology, and, you know, take them into our courses that we offer within the degree. And what we really want to do is say, no matter where you're going, even if you're going to be in a non-logical progression from human movement, such as maybe you're heading into the government service or the services or wherever you might go, that you'll take that body of knowledge about how to get people more active with you and be part of, we hope, a sort of a broader social change. So we've done pretty well as far as the program goes. So that's, first of all, we have a lot of our staff actually receive internal and also national teaching awards. So really proud of our teaching record. We think we do a good job of teaching, and certainly you know, the student feedback supports that. We also achieve what's called an ERA ranking of 4. Now, if you're not following research, that might not be that exciting. But it certainly is to us. What it's saying is that our research is above world-class standard. So we are one of the few institutions in Australia to actually get 3 or above. Okay, so we are the best in the state as far as research goes in human movement, and one of the best in Australia, and certainly we think we're up there in the world. I think the other thing is that we're part of a university which is just continuing to climb. So we're kind of really excited by the fact that, you know, our little program, Human Movement, is sort of contributing really well to this growth of the institution as a whole in becoming more and more the top of the tree. We know that UniSA does very well in terms of research income, and we know that we have a high level of academics with a doctorate, and that includes our program. So I'm actually one of the few people in my program who's yet to complete a PhD, and it doesn't have an international research record. And so every day when I walk down the corridors, I'm talking to people that, you know, are basically on the world stage, are, you know, constantly referred to in all the literature that is read. We know that we do other things other than just teach within our program and teach the courses. We have strong community links, and we try to develop them and foster them constantly. So we have things such as our mobile allied health clinic, we have our own health benefits, health and fitness centre, we have an exercise physiology clinic, we have relationships with a number of elite sporting groups as well as sub-elite sporting groups, and there's opportunities within the program to actually get out and work with other programs, sporting programs, health programs and so forth, through the field study option. One of the things I always get asked by people is, what sort of job will I get at the end of human movement? And the first thing we should say is it's intended to be, if you like, a non-vocational degree. It doesn't mean that you can't get a job at the end of it. It just means that what we've tried to do is to prepare people for the broad range of possibilities that can occur within human movement. So we're very much focused on trying to introduce people, if you like, to what the field is, give them a chance to actually get engaged with it, and then sort of as we work towards second, third year, then they can kind of work their way through what the fields that they're really passionate about. And I suppose that's one of our main focus, if you like, is to try and help students discover what they're really passionate about and what will get them turning up each day for their employment and, you know, being part of change rather than just doing what's always been done. So, we have a number of dedicated study pathways. One is health and PE. So, our students, if they do the health and PE pathway, are prepared to go into the Master of Teaching, which is another 18 months at the end of the program. You can do that in 2 years as well if you want a little bit more time. And our program articulates really nicely with both middle and secondary, primary and middle, and also junior primary and primary. Another pathway we have, which is just a sub-pathway, is outdoor education. So a lot of our students that do this will eventually end up being teachers, but quite often on graduation they'll go and travel the world or work elsewhere in Australia in private industry, in tourism or outdoor education private providers. Another field that's been really successful has been health promotion. And this is a field that people don't automatically think of when they start human movement. But what we know is that those who've gone down that field have been getting some amazing jobs working in the field of changing health behaviours for government organisations, private organisations, non-government. And we've been staggered at how successful they've been at doing that and also getting some fantastic feedback on what they've been able to do as a result of the background in health and nutrition. Exercise and sports science continues to be a pathway. A lot of students, when they start human movement, say, I'm interested in sport, and I'm interested in elite, you know, being involved with elite athletes. And one of the things we say is don't lose that dream, okay, but the reality is, in terms of exercise and sports science particularly, is that it's not a large industry. It's not an industry that has, jobs just falling off the back of a truck, okay? It's an industry where you have to work hard, it's highly competitive, you use your relationships, your connections, but if you do, there are some opportunities. And we certainly foster that, okay? We will say, though, that outside of sport, there are some other domains where there's plenty of opportunities for people who do the exercise and sports science pathway. So, working as a exercise scientist, health project supervisor, corporate health and fitness, we have a number of our graduates working for private companies that, specialise in basically getting whole organisations to adopt healthier attitudes and lifestyles. And finally, of course, we pride ourselves on the fact that at the end of 3 years, if you do well, we offer an excellent research pathway, which is becoming, increasingly popular, but also increasingly in demand. After you've finished your degree, as I said at the start, it's perhaps a non-vocational degree. Most students will do some sort of postgrad studies. Perhaps not necessarily straight away, they might actually go and work for a while, but then look to postgrad studies. So, first of all, we have the clinical exercise physiology, so it's a postgraduate diploma in that. That's a 1-year course and basically at the end of that you graduate as a clinical exercise physiologist. We have the Master of Physiotherapy, which is a 2-year program, and that's obviously a competitive entry as well, along with Occupational Therapy and the Master of Dietetics. But our graduates also go into other areas that we don't offer at the university as well, such as paramedics and so forth. So there's quite a lot of opportunities once you've done the human movement program to go on. And the feedback we get from our students who've done this is that it's been a really good general pathway so that when they do get into those fields, all right, they've got this rich body of knowledge that they take into it. And ironically, at the moment, and in the area of physiotherapy, you actually, on graduation, you graduate with a Master's of Physiotherapy, not a Bachelor of Physiotherapy, so therefore you're actually at a higher level. So, we also try and make people really explicit now that research is a good pathway to look at. Perhaps not so exciting when you're at school and you're thinking, I can't wait to just finish my year 12 and, you know, I'm not so sure that I want to sort of be studying for the rest of my life. But what we can say is that we've provided some excellent opportunities for research, and those people have had some awesome opportunities to go around the world, to work internationally, and to be part of some really significant changes in our society. So normally that would be the 3-year degree, you do an honours degree for 12 months on top of it, and then a doctorate after that. So it does seem like a long time, but it's amazing how quickly that time goes once you get started. So we have, I guess, some scholarships available. So for people interested in research, we have these summer scholarships, and we have the Samson Institute of Health Research, which provides scholarships. But there's opportunities in all our research centres that we have. So we have the one for Exercise for Health and Human Performance, International Centre for Allied Health Evidence, Population Health and Epidemiology, so that's the study of broad-scale health and how we can improve that. Obviously our Nutritional Physiology Research Centre, so it's basically looking at how nutrition can improve quality of life. Health and Use of Time, so that's very much about how we use our time and how we can live in a way that's more conducive to health-related quality of life. And finally, a really interesting research centre we have, which is called the Body and Mind Research Centre, which focuses on how we can actually get people to manage pain better by using the neuroplastic nature of our brains rather than through drugs and other means. So, what does it look like? Well, if you start human movement, your first half of the year, if we go over to the left, those top 4 courses are what you'll do in that first half. So we have Human Anatomy 100, Human Physiology 1, Foundations of Health, and Motor Learning Control. The reason I'm pausing there, because I think that's inaccurate. Sorry, that should have been updated. There has been a change since then. We've got the wrong slide. No worries, I did update it on the master, but these things happen. So I'm thinking, well, I'm the program director, surely I should know about these changes. I'll tell you what's actually happening. So you're still doing anatomy, you're still doing physiology, you're still doing foundations of health, but you're doing a course now called Foundations of Human Movement and Exercise and Sports Studies. So basically what that's about is getting you to know about the broad fields it's all about. So in your first year, you'll actually meet all of our key researchers that we have in our program, and they'll tell you about where it's going and what the opportunities are, and tell you exactly what's happening in terms of the latest research. Second half of the year, you'll do sociology and group dynamics, as well as lifespan, growth and development. Okay? And you get your first elective at the end of first year. All right? So that's your first taste of one of your study pathways. Thereafter, in second year, you've got some core courses still, and finally, in your third year, it's all your study stream elective pathway. So this is what the study stream electives look like. You've got mainly exercise and sports science, health and PE, and a lot of people combine health and PE with outdoor ed and health promotion. You can actually mix those areas up a little bit. The only one that is quite restrictive, I suppose, or two really, is exercise and sports science. If you want to get into the clinical exercise physiology graduate diploma, you need to meet certain criteria. If you're going to go into physio, OT, any of those, you need to make sure you've done the courses which allow you to get in. If you want to do health and PE to secondary level, then you need to make sure you've picked up the health and PE pathway. If you haven't done the health and PE pathway, you can still do health and PE education, just you can't get into upper secondary, if you like. All right, so entry requirements. Obviously, the ATAR is in that. Hopefully, you picked up one of those booklets. It tells you exactly what we had last year. We don't know next year. We can just tell you our best guess. Being aware that if you don't get the ATAR required, there may be other ways that you might be able to enter. And they're listed there, and more information can be found on the uni website, but also if you want to come and speak to us. Just a final plug. On Sunday, 15th of September, we actually have a specific health science, if you like, open day. And that's very much to try and get people into the facilities where you'll be taught. So you'll be shown around labs and clinics and so forth, and teaching spaces. There'll be staff on hand who can actually talk to you directly about what's going to occur. So if you are interested in this field, I'd strongly recommend you come along, and they're certainly trying to encourage you with a bunch of JB Hi-Fi vouchers and those sorts of things.